what will be covered on lecture exam 5 and don't forget about your lab practical on Thursday. One announcement is I need more time to set it up in the morning, so we won't start until 9:30, so you can sleep in a little bit. 9:30 start. We took the first one, it takes a little more than an hour. And after that, around 11 o'clock-ish, whenever we finish that, I'm not sure the exact minute, but the rest of the day will be lecture following the lab practical. That's for sure. Okay, so that's Thursday. Right now, a lecture on blood and its components. The first picture is you're basically spinning down the blood using a centrifuge. When you fractionate blood, you can see the different components of blood in that test tube there. So whole blood is a little more than half plasma. Plasma is the fluid part of blood, and it's basically water with some solutes in it. Water with solutes. And the solutes, well, I'll define them later, what they are. So this is a little more than half blood, maybe about 55%. About less than 1% is a little white layer of white blood cells and platelets called the buffy coat. Thin, white layer of the white blood cells and the platelets. Leukocytes, leuko means white. Platelets are also called thrombocytes because they can help start blood clotting. Blood clotting is a different lecture though. So it's a very small percentage of blood, but that's basically your immune system right there. And the platelets help stop bleeding, so they're very important. The key function of blood is to help transport the blood gases, and the erythrocytes are for that. Those are the red blood cells. So the buffy coat is like less than 1% of whole blood, but the erythrocytes or the red blood cells they carry bind O2. O2 transport is their main gig, okay? It's about something like 45%. Most of the blood, well, I should say, about half of blood is what's called the formed elements. That's kind of a weird term. It's just the blood cells. But some of these blood cells here are not true cells, so they kind of have to call them formed elements. But it includes, you ever see that term, formed elements, is referring to the second two points, the buffy coat and the erythrocytes. Okay, those are the blood cells or formed elements. Formed. And I'll tell you how they're formed. It's part of this lecture. So when people use the term whole blood, that means everything. The blood cells and the plasma. Okay, that's my next slide. Here's a picture of real blood spun down. You can see the straw-colored plasma on top when you fractionate the blood. And blood is slightly basic. 7.35 to 7.45 pH.
reason why there's a range
.735 to .745 is the difference between arterial blood and venous blood. Arterial blood, well, I should say venous blood, has a higher CO2 content, and that tends to acidify the blood a little bit. So, venous blood, arterial blood. It's about 8% of your body weight. It's about 5 or 6 liters for a man, 4 to 5 liters for a female. On pregnant moms, the blood volume can almost double. So here are the terms: whole blood, all the formed elements in the plasma. Okay. Well, let me get my pointer. And the term serum, well, here's what you might not know. You know, if you just let blood sit in a test tube, there are clotting factors that will react with the charged surface of the glass tube and form a blood clot. Okay? If you don't need the clotting factors as part of your analysis, you can just siphon off the serum. So basically, serum is plasma without clotting factors. I guess you should know that. Serum is plasma without clotting factors. All right, so I'll talk about how blood clots, but that's why blood circulates. You don't give a chance for the clotting factors to accumulate for a spontaneous blood clot. If you need the clotting factors in your analysis and you don't want the clot to form in the test tube, you have to lace them with heparin. You can add EDTA. There's other things you can add to keep the blood from clotting. But if left to its own devices, blood clots. Okay. All right, so now you know what serum is. All right, let's advance the slide. Talk about some functions of blood. And a lot of these topics are handled in other chapters. For example, blood gases, which are transported. I talk about that mostly in the respiratory chapter. Okay. pH balance, I talk about that when I get to kidney. Body temperature, I don't talk about that much at all. But I did teach you, like, for example, in the upper limb, how there are superficial veins, right, that can help dissipate heat to the environment. That helps regulate body temperature. And the immunity chapter deals with physiology of the white blood cells, and I'll talk about that mostly in that lecture. But at least let me show you the main function here. Transport O2. So look at the oxygen tension or oxygen pressure here. This is considered deoxygenated. So now I'm going to put a number to it. Oxygen poor, deoxygenated. It's actually 40. It's not zero. It's not unoxygenated. It's deoxygenated. So it's about 40, so it gets close to 100 in the pulmonary circulation and the arterial blood. And then you exchange, when you have the capillary exchange, right? I did teach that, it then drops back down to 40. And so, there you have it. Now, I want to be more thorough about what's in the different components of fractionated blood. For example, I didn't tell you what the solutes were in the plasma, so let me list some of those up there. Now you can see that water is the primary component of the blood plasma, almost 92%. But some of those proteins that are soluble in this watery plasma include albumins. Albumin is a protein. It provides most of the oncotic pressure of blood. oncotic pressure is the same as the blood colloid osmotic pressure I talked about in the capillary exchange lecture. Remember, that's the pressure that draws fluids into the blood vessel. So proteins in the plasma help contribute to that oncotic pressure. The globulins we talked about are the antibodies, the immunoglobulins. So I'll put immunoglobulins, antibodies. Produced by the B cells, well, we'll get to that. Fibrinogen is a clotting factor. Roman numerals to these clotting factors, and they number them like the cranial nerves. So they use like Roman numerals for this. So this is clotting factor 1, fibrinogen. So you know those are the most important ones. I won't kind of list these here. When they say waste products, they're usually talking about nitrogenous waste products. That's usually what the body has to deal with. Alright, and so the different types of formed elements, platelets, white blood cells, red blood cells, I'll go through each of these individually later in the lecture. For now, I just want to move forward and tell you how the formed elements are formed. So we'll spend time talking about how red blood cells are formed, white blood cells, and platelets, how they're all formed from the bone marrow. Blood cells come from the bone marrow. We'll start with the formation of red blood cells. How are the formed elements formed? Formation of RBCs or erythrocytes. Erythro means red a lot of times. And so bone marrow the red bone marrow, not the yellow. There's a few locations where adults have it. In the flat bones of your skull, cranium. I'll show you some other time. If you remove a skull cap and hold it up to the light, it appears splotchy because there's red marrow inside there. You have it in the sternum. I've seen that red marrow. It has kind of like a red bean paste kind of texture. You also have it in the iliac bone. That's usually the place where, if you want to get a bone marrow sample, that's usually where they go. And also proximal femur. So those are the anatomical locations of bone marrow. But let's just kind of look at what goes on in there. How do stem cells differentiate and become these different formed elements? We'll just focus on red blood cells in this slide. What you see here, imagine these stem cells are in the bone marrow. Let's say oxygen tensions get low. The kidney will secrete EPO, the target stem cells in the bone marrow to get them to commit down this pathway to become a mature red blood cell. Say you got low oxygen tension, basically hypoxia. So you got low blood pressure, whatever. The kidney can pick up on that. It helps regulate fluid balance. It has the ability to do that. It also secretes in response to that a hormone, erythropoietin. I'm just going to abbreviate it EPO for now. And when it targets the stem cell, the proerythroblast in the bone marrow, EPO is essential for differentiation past the proerythroblast stage to get that committed stem cell, committed stem cell to progress. EPO targets proerythroblasts. Those are just stem cells, basically. Whenever you see the suffix blast to describe a cell, that usually means the cell could differentiate into another cell. In this case, it'll become the red blood cell. Now, when you stain these and look at them under a microscope, they take up different dyes. And the proerythroblast stage, with EPO, it can differentiate to this, what they call the phase one on the slide. So phase one in the development of red blood cells is primarily, okay, think about what red blood cells do. They have to transport oxygen. So you need a protein that can bind O2. And that protein is hemoglobin. So it's like, okay, my job in my life as a cell, I'm gonna bind oxygen. I need to make hemoglobin. To get ready to do that, you start synthesizing the machinery needed to make proteins, like rRNA, which is what ribosomes are. So phase one is ribosome synthesis. Okay, it's like you're preparing to make hemoglobin, but you're not making it yet. You're just getting the machinery to do it. And so during this phase, the cell takes up, it presents a basophilia. Okay. Basophilic phase. That's that purplish bluish color that they're using for the phase one cell. That's usually what you see. When you progress to phase two, you're starting to accumulate lots of hemoglobin, and the cell is shrinking because it's starting to get rid of the organelles it doesn't need. So instead of calling them erythroblasts, so I guess consider phase one the erythroblast phase. Phase two, they use the term normal blast. Normal blast phase. And in this phase, the cell is accumulating hemoglobin that it's been making. Cell accumulates hemoglobin, is often abbreviated capital H, lowercase b. And because it's starting to accumulate hemoglobin kind of takes up a red dye, and we call it eosin or eosinophilic. Eosinophilic phase. My first job out of college, I worked for a pathologist who stained these tissues, and I would always do an H&E stain. H, hematoxylin, which stained for the basophil stuff, and the E was eosin. And you just stick the tissue in there. You don't know what it's going to take up. The H or the E, okay, this or that. But, you know, you rinse the cell off, the tissues off, and you look at it, and you see what the cell took up. If a cell takes up the red dye and appears red, okay, not purple, appears red, what it means is it's starting to become filled with hemoglobin. Because essentially, what a red blood cell is just a bag of hemoglobin. That's red, literally red. Your blood is red, right? Because that's why it starts to take up the red dye. It appears red, takes up the red dye. Notice you're ejecting organelles. The cells are shrinking. in size. That's good, because if you're going to be a competent red blood cell, you got to squeeze through the capillaries. You're going to be pretty small. Okay. They are ejecting organelles. The last thing you eject is the nucleus, shown in the picture. Okay. Eject nucleus last. Because once you eject the nucleus, you can't make the hemoglobin anymore. You don't have the gene to transcribe. So anyways, that would be phase three. I should just kind of put that with phase three. So put eject nucleus with phase three. And then that cell, still in the bone marrow, is called a reticulocyte. And that cell will enter the circulation, enter those sinusoidal capillaries, right? Those are the leaky capillaries, let a cell in. Sinusoidal capillaries. Get into the bloodstream. And eventually you'll pucker and become a mature urethrocyte, okay, in the blood. So it goes reticulocyte, and then the sinusoidal capillaries get into the blood. Urethrocyte. I usually don't see these on blood smear slides, the reticulocytes. If you see a lot of them, the patient maybe bleeding somewhere. Maybe they have a slow bleeding ulcer, because it's like, why would you see a lot of these? Because the cell is like making a lot of new blood to replenish the blood that's being lost, I guess. So it could be evidence of blood loss somewhere in the body. Okay. And the other things that are needed besides EPO are iron and B12. Erythropoietin, EPO, iron, B12
to help make blood.
Yes. Yeah, I can't really show you that until I show you hemoglobin structure. Iron is a component of hemoglobin, the heme-containing iron. And I'll show you a picture of that coming up. What I can say about B12, B12 helps you extract iron from the fujui in the gut. So this whole process takes about 3 days. The average lifespan of a red blood cell in circulation is about 120 days. Okay. And I like this figure because it shows you in graph form the decline of the RNA, the ribosomes, and then where you start to accumulate the hemoglobin, which is when you would enter the circulation. Okay. And then you have that color change too, from basophilic down here to eosinophilic, basically from purple to red. That kind of tells the histologist what kind of cell they're looking at. So the erythrocytes, the mature ones, again, their job is to bind the O2. It's remarkable that we have cells that can bind O2. You don't have to like put it through a chemical reaction. You don't depend on an enzyme. It just binds it and releases it, okay? Picks it up, drops it off, without changing the chemical structure of the O2. So let's talk about some key features of red blood cells that you might not know about. Just list them up here. Oops. So they're dedicated to transporting expiratory gases, and we really mean it, because you just learned they spit out all the organelles, even the nucleus. They can't do anything except for what they already got, which is they only contain hemoglobin. Red blood cells are just bags of hemoglobin. They can only do this. They have biconcave shape that creates a high surface volume ratio. They're kind of flattened pancakes, kind of shaped like this. Concave means it kind of curves away from you. So biconcave means it kind of curves in on both sides. So you're kind of flat like this. So that kind of, that shape kind of gives you more surface area, which is good for picking up and dropping off gases at the lung or at the systemic capillaries. And so the shape is advantageous. And also this shape is easier to navigate through very narrow capillaries. Okay. So that way, all cytoplasm is a short distance to the surface for ease of gas exchange, which I stated on the slide. Now, the next slide, I have some pretty pictures of the red blood cells. Here's the sectional view. Here's the average diameter of a cell, 7.2 to 8.4 microns. Okay. And the reason why the size is important, you don't really have to memorize these numbers. But the size is important. If you have a normal size, that means you have normal red blood cells that are producing normal amounts of hemoglobin. Okay. In our slides, this is kind of what a blood smear might look like. There's no white blood cells in this smear. In a drop of blood, these red blood cells outnumber the white blood cells almost 1,000 to 1. So they're hard to find. I don't know if you can see these little specks right there, right there. What are the little specks? Which formed elements are those?
Platelets.
Yeah. Okay, here you see this rouleau, this kind of stacking of the red blood cells. I think I mentioned it before. And here is that, answers the question that was asked earlier, why do you need iron to make blood? The heme contains iron, right there. Iron-containing heme is what we call it. So let's talk about hemoglobin structure. You call those, what's a tetramer? Hemoglobin is a tetramer. Four components, two alpha, two beta chains. That's what you see there. Two alpha, two beta chains, each with an iron containing heme. H-E-M-E. And it's that structure, this, the iron containing heme, that actually binds the O2. Okay. And I have some numbers at the top there. So what you see from this picture is one molecule of hemoglobin can bind, one heme can bind one O2. So each molecule of hemoglobin has four hemes. So you can bind four O2s. A single red blood cell may have as many as 280 million hemoglobin molecules. So if you do the math, that's one red blood cell can bind over a billion molecules of O2. Now that number is kind of hard to work with. So if you do the units conversion thing, and basically shrink this down. The oxygen carrying capacity of hemoglobin is about 1.39 mils of O2 per gram. That is the O2 carrying capacity of hemoglobin. 1.39 mils O2 per gram hemoglobin. You take a deciliter of blood, 100 mils of blood. Whole blood, and you just kind of macerate the red blood cells. and measure the hemoglobin concentration. You should have about 12 to 18 grams of hemoglobin per deciliter of blood, on average. So that's the normal range, basically. The other quick way to assess the oxygen carrying capacity of a person's blood is just spin it down and see how much crit there is, right? So this is a more direct way. You're measuring how much grams of hemoglobin, but hematocrit is another estimate. So let's talk about hematocrit determination. What's shown on the slide is not hard to understand. It's a proportion, right? You have the whole blood, some top mark, and you spin down the crit. So you're trying to figure out how much that is relative to the whole. Right? So that top mark, whatever it is, whatever you measure it to be, the top mark doesn't matter. It's the proportion of X to Y that matters. You understand that? It's a proportion. Doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter. Proportion, the proportions matter. So you want to know how much X is as a percentage of a Y. Okay, basically that's how you would do it. And it's a unitless number, right? It's a proportion. And the normal range is like 37 to 54. NL is normal, 37 to 54. HCT, that's kind of the normal range for crit. This is the normal range for, you know, hemoglobin concentration. So if you got normal crit, normal hemoglobin values, basically the oxygen can carry blood well enough. You don't worry about that patient. So here's the normal range per deciliter of blood. I used to assign a physio X activity for this. I don't do it anymore, but we can discuss what you might have done. For example, on average, males have a little more tissue, we weigh a little more than females. So on average, males have a higher hemoglobin concentration value. Maybe the average for male is like 14 to 18, and maybe for healthy female, the range is 12 to 16. So there's some overlap, but basically in an activity, we would try to show that the healthy male has a little bit more hemoglobin. What would you expect the value to be for someone with some kind of anemia? It should be basically higher or lower than the normal range. You would expect a low value. Okay. Polycythemia is the opposite of anemia. So you might expect a value greater than the normal range. We say Olympic athlete, someone who's training a lot, training increases the blood values. So you might expect this value to be higher in someone who's training vigorously. I'm gonna show you a picture of anemia and polycythemia. Well, here's a picture of it. low blood. For whatever reason, and there are different reasons we can go through here. But what I want to show you right off the bat is, do you see the density difference in the red blood cells? Here, they're packed tight. You can see some white blood cells there. Here, they're much less dense, and the morphology of the cell is irregular. You don't see that nice biconcave shape here. This is sickle cell anemia. I'll talk about that more later. I just wanted to show you the difference between polycythemia and anemia. Here are some typical causes of anemia. It could just be blood loss. Okay. A slow bleeding ulcer, hemorrhoids. Okay. Somewhere in the body where you always have to make up for lost blood. Could be nutritional. Iron deficiency. Well, it's easy to treat. Just eat iron. Well, iron supplements or, you know, collard greens, or the deep leafy green vegetables. Things that have lots of iron in it. There are others. Okay. Pernicious anemia is a lack of B12. The reason why a lack of B12 is important, I mentioned it earlier, because B12, which is found in meats, it's important for the absorption of iron into the red blood cells. Lack of B12 could be a cause. Lack of B12 helps absorb iron. A lack of intrinsic factor, which is from the gut mucosa, that could cause a problem. And usually you see this in the elderly. As the stomach mucosa atrophies, there may be a lack of intrinsic factor. Well, intrinsic factor helps absorb B12, so that could be a cause. Lack of intrinsic factor. Here's another picture of anemia. This is an iron deficient anemia. The density of the cells is reduced. The red blood cells are kind of clumping. These cells have, they don't have the puckering or sickling like we saw in sickle cell anemia, because it's a different kind. But compared to normal, you can definitely see differences there in terms of the density. The iron deficient anemia, you might see cell size reduce. This is from a textbook, and it shows you the normal on the left next to the iron deficient anemia on the right. And usually, you can't tell on this slide, but you call these smaller cells microcytes. Okay. Small cells. So iron deficient anemia. The RBCs may be less than 7 microns in diameter. And also look at how the cell looks, not just the size. They look poorly hemoglobin. It looks like they have low amounts of hemoglobin because they're very pale looking. The light shines through them more, so they're thinner and they're smaller. I'll just put low HB. They don't have a lot. That's why they're small. So that can be measured in a blood workup. Looking for the microcytes. So the other one I showed you, the sickle cell anemia, that's a genetic inheritance. Where the RBCs are deficient in HB, the cells pucker or sickle when oxygen tension is a little bit lower rather than being more biconcave and round. So sickle cell is one genetic kind. Thalassemia is another. writing genetically inherited forms of anemia. I have a slide on the sickle cell one next. So sickle cell and thalassemia. So, actually I have this one right here. There's minor and major. I have the minor kind. I inherited one faulty gene. And but in high school, I ran track and I played soccer. I did the two things you're not supposed to do when you have this. Oh well, it's okay. I guess I'm evidence you can have a normal life, do whatever you want. The point is, it's a genetic inheritance. This one's pretty interesting. This condition, anemia is not good, but it confers, when you have the sickle cell trait, this one's heterozygous. When you have the sickle cell trait, it confers resistance to the malaria parasite. So you have a selective advantage in areas where malaria is present. Okay. Severe symptoms come with homozygous patients. Okay. Here's a closer picture of the sickled or puckered cells. Right? Treatment is, well, you transfuse them, or maybe a bone marrow transplant, but they need to be transfused if they have severe symptoms. Here's a picture of a cell sickling with low oxygen tension. It's just the one amino acid mutation at that location. Okay. So the opposite problem of anemia is polycythemia, where the blood gets all kind of goopy and thick because of the high crit content. There's blood doping, I'll talk about that. Altitude, which you encounter just by driving up to Lake Tahoe, can elicit this reaction. So here's some numbers, basically, but just kind of look pictorially, you see how tightly packed the red blood cells appear on a drop of blood. So what happens when you drive up to altitude, they call it acclimatization. The body is like realizing there's less, the air is thin. So you're getting less O2 per breath, and the body reacts to that. So here are the effects of altitude. Whoops. Barometric pressure decreases with increasing altitude. Again, driving up the mountain, resulting in less O2 per inhalation. This creates a hypoxic environment. Altitude. Basically, you get less O2 per breath, leads to hypoxia. It's been noted that with each increase of elevation, your O2 consumption, your max O2, your VO2 max, decreases about 3% per 1,000 feet elevation. Here's the figure for that. I already talked about this. EPO is secreted in response to hypoxic conditions, you know, like driving up to the mountain somewhere. And then so it targets the bone marrow to increase your crit. It's in the presence of hypoxia. Hypoxia induces, you got EPO? You see an increase in HCT, my shorthand for hematocrit. Now, EPO is really important with hypoxia, but let's say you don't have EPO. Hypoxia, no EPO. You're going to have no change in crit. Change in HCT, therefore hypoxia not corrected. So that's been shown and shows you the value and importance of erythropoietin. The other thing I mentioned mentioned about how you could get polycythemia as a blood doping. Usually, athletes who depend on the oxygen carrying capacity of their blood will do this illegally. It's not legal in any sport that I know of. Well, how you would do it, autologous, if you're a safe cheater, do it with your own blood. I've heard of a case where in the 80s, I think it was the 1984 U.S. Olympic cycling team, they did it with other people's blood and led to all kinds of health problems for them. But the principle is just take out some of your own blood, put it in the freezer, okay? Train, get your blood back up. And then the day of, day before, give yourself a little boost, okay? Take that out, thaw it out, and drop your own bag of blood on yourself. Increase your blood's O2 carrying capacity. Yeah.
Isn't the thing like if you train in higher altitudes or something?
Yes.
You increase like the levels, and then when you go back and compete,
then
the oxygen is better.
Yeah. The question was asked is, well, if you train at altitude and get your blood up, can't you go back down to sea level and have an advantage? Now, the studies I came across when I was an undergrad, they would take cross-country athletes up to the mountains, train for a few weeks, and come back down. And what those studies showed is the training effects could not persist. They did not have an advantage over the short term. What I have heard is if you live there, then you could have an advantage. But just going up for a short time, not going to do it. They did see improvements, but it could just be because they were training anyways. So they weren't sure if you trained at sea level or trained at altitude, if those increases that they saw made a difference. So I guess the short answer is, no, you can't do that. You have to live there to see the effects persist. Okay, so if you're kind of cheating with your own blood, this is how you do it. Just take it out, train for a few weeks, the day of the event, reinfuse and get a boost. Here's a picture of what that would look like in graph form. You do it when you're training. So a few weeks prior to your event, you got the removal. So your crit drops a certain amount. Then you train, get it back up to at least your normal value, right? And then reinfuse day before the event to give yourself a boost. Okay. Now there are some events like the Tour de France. The cyclists are the most notorious for doing this. It's like, that thing is 21 days. It takes place over 23 days, 21 stages. Day long, riding your bike, it's kind of crazy. But anyways, I always wonder if like you go to these hotels where they're staying during the stages, like they're all like dropping bags of blood on themselves. I don't know, you're not supposed to, it's cheating. But cyclists are the most notorious, always hear about it in the news. The most notorious one was Lance Armstrong. This is old news now. But I remember they came out with this 1,000-page report, and I read part of it. Trust me, these guys wouldn't do it unless it didn't work. It works. I mean, everyone knows what he did on a bike. It's too bad that his name got smeared. And I've heard anecdotally he's not a really good guy anyways, but he did a lot for testicular cancer research. But you can read the report. I'm not trying to smear Lance Armstrong. It's just his case is the one I've heard about the most. It's too bad. It's like, if there are a lot of people that are cheating in your sport, you kind of have to do it to stay competitive. Otherwise, you'll lose your sponsor. You can't do it. Okay. You remember Greg LeMond? Okay, older people do. He was the last great U.S. cyclist that didn't cheat. Okay, like the 80s and the 90s, he didn't do it. He didn't blood dope. But he won the Tour de France a few times. Now, when he came back, he had a hunting accident. And when he came back and started to compete against guys like this who were doping, he couldn't do it. He couldn't compete. And he was the best. So, which is why the organization needs to really crack down on these people who are doing it. All right, so I want to shift gears now to blood typing. Now, we have a lab on this coming up on Friday. I want to make sure you're well prepared for it. I'm going to cover this today. Blood typing, the reason why you want to type blood is many times people in the hospital who need blood for surgery or whatever, you have to give people other people's blood. You don't want to do it without creating transfusion reactions. For example, if you're a cancer patient and get the chemo, you need to be transfused. Those toxic chemicals that are killing the cancer cells or killing everything else in you, including the bone marrow, they need to be transfused. But anyways, a little history here. When blood transfusions were first attempted from one person to another, immediate or delayed agglutination and hemolysis of RBCs occurred, leading to death. And that's a tough way to find out, oh, I guess we can't do this. So it was soon discovered that bloods of different people have different antigenic properties, so that antibodies in the plasma of the recipient of the donated blood will react with the antigens on the RBC surfaces of the donated blood. So here's the key. Why is there a reaction? You're receiving someone else's blood. Your antibodies in your immune system see that transfused blood as a foreign invader that it needs to attack. That's what your immune system always does, okay? And what is attacking? It's attacking the antigens of the donated blood. That's not your blood, okay? So they've figured out ways to do this by figuring out the types of blood. So the types are depending on the type of antigen on the red blood cell surface. Here are the different types. Well, let me define them. I don't care that you remember the rarest blood type or the most common blood types. I want you to learn the mechanics behind how one person can donate to another with or without cross-reaction. Okay. So let me define the blood types. So when people say blood type, what they really mean is what kinds of antigens are on your RBCs. That's type. Blood type, sometimes people say blood group, they usually say type. A blood type is, you know, asking the question, which antigens are on the RBCs? I'll frame it in the form of a question, because when you donate blood, in this lecture we'll talk about, you're pretty much just donating the packed RBCs. You just resuspend in sterile saline and give it to the recipient. Okay. I mean, when you donate your whole blood, they fractionate it. I mean, they save all the fractions, the buffy coat, the plasma. They repurpose it for whatever reason. But we'll just talk about the donation of the RBCs. That's the most common thing we see here. And so there are actually 35 different blood groups that are known. But the most important one, the number one type group, is the ABO system. In the ABO system, for example, if you have type A blood, that means the A antigen is present. Therefore, if you type B, which antigen do you have? The B antigen is present. Type O, O is not an antigen. O means you do not have A or B. Neither A or B antigen is present. They're both absent. A, B antigens absent. Type O. You could be type AB, although it's very rare. That would mean you have both A and B antigens are present. Type AB. A and B antigens are present. So that's the number one blood group that we type for. Number two is the RH system. RH antigen, also known as antigen D, type D, capital D. Put a D in parentheses there. The RH stands for rhesus monkey. The person who first discovered this, like back in like 1937, a long time ago, he thought it resembled the antigen seen in those monkeys. But the name stuck. We call it RH or type D. So usually for these two groups, this is noted with a plus or minus as a suffix after the ABO system. Okay. So if you see a little plus, positive, that means you are positive for this antigen. That means the RH antigen is present. If you see the little plus after the AB whatever. RH antigen is present. If you see a negative sign, that means the RH antigen is absent. So pretty much, the ABO and the RH system, we're just giving you two blood groups to know, right? Three antigens, the A, the B, the RH, that's it. Let's go back to the first slide we looked at. Let's remember that, spin down the blood, donate the packed RBCs. Depending on if you're the donor or the recipient, here, let me ask the question here. What do blood donors really donate that might be a problem in the recipient? Antibodies or antigens? It's the antigens, which is a word that means antibody generator. So if you give it to a person who's going to react with it, their antibodies are going to like attack it. It could lead to death. So we want to make sure that doesn't happen. You want to type the blood and make sure there's no cross-reaction. Donor's blood attacked by recipient's immune system antibodies, okay, which are also called agglutinins, may cause agglutination. So this is what we're trying to prevent. And blood typing prevents these types of transfusion reactions which involve agglutination. Okay. Agglutination may occur. Blood's all clumped up. It's going to diminish the oxygen carrying capacity. The clumped blood cells impede flow, they rupture, they release the hemoglobin, which can clog your kidneys and lead to kidney failure. There's all kinds of problems. You need to prevent it. Here's a picture of agglutination or a cross reaction. They illustrate the antigens, say A for example, with these little blue triangles on the cell surface. And those antigens are like how your immune system identifies your self cells from your non-self cells. So if you're receiving non-self blood, basically, and you have an opposing antibody, this is what agglutination looks like. Okay. So typing correctly prevents agglutination. Blood typing for ABO as well as the RH systems, it prevents agglutination. Donors, RBCs, the antigen, that you get from somebody else, the donor donated to somebody else. Their antigens on the RBC are being attacked by the recipients, the person who receives the blood, antibodies. AB for short. Antibodies attacking the antigen of the blood they're receiving. Those cells are non-self, and we're trying to prevent that. So that's why I made this slide. When you're trying to determine if donating blood is okay, if it's safe, you consider that the donor's RBCs do not have antigens that will react with the recipient's antibodies. Okay, so that's what you consider. You consider the donor's RBCs, their antigens, and then the recipient's, what antibodies will they have in their immune system? You can deduce all this. So let's first figure out how by going through all the blood types for those two groups, the AB and the RH. Let's do all of them. For example, let's start with how about a negative. Remember what the negative sign refers to? Which system?
RH.
is absent. So let me draw a circle representing red blood cell. There's three antigens. There's A, there's B, there's RH. Which one would this person have? Just the A? Yeah. How about little triangles for that? So let me get a little key here. Triangle is A antigen. Here's the thing. If there's an antibody against it, in this lecture I just call it A antibody with the same shape. A antibody. Sometimes books will say anti-A, which means the antibody against antigen A. So let's continue with the shape theme. Let's pretend that a circle will be the symbol for B antigen, and let's have an antibody with a specific region that fits the circle shape. And the third antigen is RH. Let's use a little square as a symbol for the RH, or D, right? Either one, RH antigen. And then that an antibody that fits that shape is the antibody against RH. Okay, so I'm very thorough about blood typing. This is gonna be the written portion of your next exam. So I wanna make sure everyone's clear on it. Well, anyways, this is the key. What you can deduce is that if you have type A negative blood, you don't have, this person does not have antibody A, right? Why would you have an antibody to attack yourself? You wouldn't. What you should assume is that the other two antibodies are present. Assume they've been sensitized and they got the other two. So what are the other two?
B
antibody. Yeah. B and RH. Anti-B, anti-RH. Assume that's in their plasma, that's their crit. So that's for type A. So let's do another type. Type A positive. Two antigens are present, the A and the RH. Yeah? Yeah, if they don't have the antigen, assume they have the antibody against it. Yeah. So for A positive person, I'm drawing two types of antigens, the A and the RH. And what antibody should you assume they have? B. Tracking what I'm doing here.
Yeah.
I'm figure out a different type. Okay, good, let's move on. Type B negative. On the RBCs, expect to find the B antigen. We're using circles. And nothing else, that's it. And assume that they would have the antibody against A and Rh. So for type B positive, two antigens are present. B, I'll draw little circles, and Rh, I'll draw little squares. And the antibody that they would have is the antibody against A. Okay, you could have type AB. Let's do AB negative. It's probably the most rare one, but what does it mean? It means that that person has the A and the B antigens present. A, little triangles, B, circles. Those are present. There's no Rh, but assume they have the antibody against Rh. Okay, so then you have type AB positive. Okay, so all three of those antigens are present. The A, little circles, the B, triangles, and I'll draw little squares for the Rh antigen. And they would not, they don't have no antibodies against A, B, or Rh. So I'll put that. No antibodies against A, B, or Rh. So what that means is there's a special term for this blood type. They call them the universal recipient. And maybe you've heard of that. Now, why do you think that term fits?
Because they can accept blood from anyone.
Yeah, and the reason for that is, take it a step further, there's going to be no cross-reaction. They don't have any antibodies that will attack any of these antigens we're talking about. Okay? Universal. All right. Oh, I forgot. Let's do O. Type O. There's no negative or positive. Type O neg. Huh. Which antigens are present on the RBCs of a type O neg person?
None.
Nothing. There's no antigens. But you would expect that they have all the antibodies against A, B, and Rh. Oh, okay. Now they call this person the universal donor. This type. And so universally, you can give this blood type to anyone else because when they receive this RBC with no antigens on it, or at least AB or Rh, there's no cross-reaction, okay? Now, if you're O negative but you need blood, who can you get it from? What's the only type?
O-negative.
Yeah, O negs can only receive from other O negs because they got all these antibodies there. If they receive any antigen, they're probably going to cross-react, so you want to assume that they're all there. Okay, then it's O positive. So they would have just the Rh antigen, and they'll have the antibody against A or B. So to get back to our slideshow here. We'll pull this down. You have the information, you should be able to solve problems. I'll ask you on the test, on the written part, can this person do anything to that person? What I don't like about this table is they don't show the second, the number two most important blood group, the Rh. I'm gonna skip that. Here's the kinds of questions I would ask. Can this person donate to that person? And I have to give you the blood types, or I have to at least have you deduce what the blood types are. So before we can answer this question, we must first consider, I ask you which of the following. So let me go to the whiteboard and show you how I solve these problems. And that's the same logic everyone should use. It never fails. I know sometimes you like to memorize different patterns, and that can work too, but as long as you know the basics of what I'm about to show you, you're on solid ground. So we got two people, give them names in this example, John and Peter. And give you their types. John is that rare type, AB negative, and Peter is A positive. So let's just kind of go through it here, what we just did. Oh, AB negative, that means which antigens are present. Which antigens are present for a person who is A, B, negative? The A and the B. So I'll use the same thing I was using before. The triangles for the A and the circles for the B. Which antibodies would be present? Just the one against Rh. Anti-Rh. All right, so for Peter, he's A positive. So which two antigens are present, the A and the Rh? So I'll draw triangles for A and squares for the Rh. Which antibody would be present in Peter's plasma?
B.
Yes, the antibody against B, a little circle-shaped antibody there. So, you know, start with that and then read the question, who's the donor in this example?
John.
John. Donor John. Recipient. Okay, so what do we consider of those choices?
B.
I heard a vote for B. Yeah, that's correct. When you're the donor, you're donating the packed RBC, so you consider this. And if you're the recipient, we're worried about your antibodies. What antibodies do you have that may cross-react? Do you see a problem?
Yes.
Yes, this anti-B would attack antigen B. This is not safe. That's no good. If you got type B blood in you, you can't donate to an A. Different blood types can't donate to each other. Now that should be obvious, but this is the real reason why. So the thinking goes, okay, well, for the same question, for John's blood type, he will have, and we figured it out, right? If he's AB, he's got this one. A and B antigens are on his RBCs. The next one I asked, for Peter's blood type, he will have, and we figured it out, he's going to have only B antibodies in his plasma, right? That's what we figured. And then answer the question, and the answer is going to be a no. But what's the correct reasoning? So not only do you have to know yes or no, you can safely donate, you have to tell me why on an exam to show that you understand what we just did. Someone said C. John's B antigen will react with Peter's B antibody. That'll be the correct reasoning. Yeah. On an exam, I expect students to tell me what cross-reacts. Sometimes students will just say there's a cross-reaction, but then you don't tell me what. And we did cover it, so no credit for that. Okay. Here are some other ones we can practice later. What I wanted to show you is this table. Recipients, donors, all the blood types. And let's see what patterns we can see here. Look at the AB positive recipient. It can receive blood from all of these, right? If you're the universal recipient. What do we say about O neg? Universal
donor.
Donor. Doesn't show it there. Here's O neg. Can donate to all of these types, everyone. Okay. So that's kind of what you see there. You can study that table and see different patterns. Some general things. Here's one that I always ask that is a stumper. Just talking about the Rh system. Can negatives donate to positives? That's the question.
Yes.
I hear a yes. That would be correct. What does the table show? Okay, if you're negatives and you try to give the people who are positive, like for example, O neg can give to an O positive. An A neg can give to an A positive. Oh, okay. If you're B negative, you can give to the same blood type who is also positive for it. So negatives can donate to positives. Now, what's the reason? It's the same reason. We're saying negatives can donate to positives. So if you're O negative, there's no antigens on your RBCs. You have all the antibodies, anti-A, anti-B, anti-RH. If you're O positive, you have the RH antigen, and you have antibodies against A and B. But when you receive the donated blood, you receive this. Donor recipient, and I was like, okay, well, it's fine. Because you're not donating an antigen that would cross-react. Okay. So let me ask you the reverse question. And I think you already know the answer, but let me ask it anyway. Can positives donate to negatives? Okay, and that's a no. You cannot safely do that. So let's reverse my switch here to, let's make Peter the donor and John the recipient. Peter's blood is O positive, so you're donating that square to this plasma here. And you see a problem. An O negative person will probably have the antibody against positive blood. Okay, so the antibody against Rh will attack that antigen. So that's why. If you're a donor, positives can't donate to negatives. That's why that's all blank, right? That's the reason. You're donating an antigen a negative person doesn't have. That negative person will probably have the antibody against it. It's the same logic every time. Okay. We're going to do a lab on Friday where we're going to type blood. You get an unknown, we're using fake blood, okay, it's safe. But the experiment will be, you don't know what antigen they have, the A, the B, the RH, you have to find out. So what you do is, you take the blood, you put it in your wells, and you add serum that has the antibody against A, B, or Rh, and see if it clumps up. Okay? Let me do number one. See that first well? You got blood in all three of them. You mix the blood with anti-A. And nothing happens. Call that, there's no agglutination. That's what they're trying to show you there. Let me ask you a question. No agglutination, is the A antigen present or absent if there's no agglutination? You got the blood's in there, you add antibody to it, nothing happens. What do you deduce? Is the A antigen present? That's a yes-no question. No, it's not there. It ain't there. If it was there, it would have clumped up. Okay, so that's a negative. Negative means no agglutination. Now we got students this. Oh, so you put negative there. What does that mean? And they say things like, oh, it means it's negative. What does that mean? Why are you doing this? It means he's negative. It's like, what? Did you attend the lecture? Okay, it means you're testing for the presence or absence of antigens. That means it ain't there, okay? So, moving on. Oh, by the way, yeah, so for this lab, I give an oral quiz, okay? Oral quiz means you gotta come up here, stand there, and I'll be sitting there, and I ask you a question, you answer it in front of me. And we do it together as a group, so you have some moral support, and so, you know, you're not up there by yourself with me, it's kind of nerve-wracking. But I do give an oral quiz for this, be ready for that. And that really helps me understand if you guys are getting it and you're ready for the written part of the test. All right, here, agglutination. Positive result. It's like the blood was there, you added antibody B to it, and it clumped up. Now, what do you deduce from that? The B antigen is present. So you know at least they're type B. And the Rh. And I got a negative result. No agglutination. It ain't there. So what's the blood type? B negative. Do the other ones. What's number two?
O positive.
O positive. There's no A. There's no B. You got a positive result for Rh. Okay. O positive for number two. Number three.
B positive.
Yeah. B is there. Rh is there, B positive. What special blood type is for? O neg, the universal donor. Okay, so, you know, that's for lab. One clinical side note, we have kids. There's a hemolytic disease called erythroblastosis fetalis. That's where, if you don't treat for it, let's say mom is Rh negative, which is rare, but it happens. But let's say that dad is Rh positive, so baby has that antigen, okay? They're using triangles, I use squares for it, but the point is, negative mom, positive baby. Hemorrhaging at delivery, maybe a little bit of baby's blood gets into mom's. That's okay, that's not gonna hurt mom, but it will sensitize mom to make a high titer of antibody against Rh. And if you don't treat for this, second baby, there could be antibodies crossing the placenta causing this condition. Okay. You just give mom Rogan, just zap it all out of there, and it's easily preventable. But this is kind of the same science here, just antibodies attacking antigens to form blood. Okay. This last slide says PhysioX blood analysis. I don't assign this anymore. If you don't have PhysioX, don't worry about it. If you have PhysioX and you think you might learn from it, and you should want to do it for fun, you got a lot of time on your hands. You watched everything on Netflix and nothing else to do. I would do these ones. I think you can learn from it. Okay, just for fun, just for study. I'm gonna stop now and still have some time. The lab practical is Thursday. What time do we start?
9:30.
One other thing I want to announce is, let's talk about schedule, because you got another lecture exam coming right up on top of you. 5. And it's on the schedule for Friday.